COP26 is not going to go as far in terms of commitments that Boris Johnson was hoping, but the first analysis post some significant deals suggests for the first time we could be headed to limiting warming of the globe by fewer than 2 degrees. 1.9 degrees is the amount so far. It comes after some significant deals in terms of reducing methane and phasing out coal. Joining me live is Minister for Resources and Northern Australia, Keith Pitt. Thanks for your time. So these deals that were announced, pretty significant. The fact that they're saying now we could be on track to limit global warming to below 1.9 degrees, do you welcome that development?
Well, Tom, great to be with you from quarantine, home quarantine in Bundaberg, where I'm watched on by my very faithful blue heeler. But look, in terms of the commentary around coal, I mean, well, let's deal with that first. That while there's a market, and there's going to be a market for many decades to come, Australia will look to fill that market. We have a high-quality product. It's in great demand around the world. In fact, in the last quarter, we've seen it in terms of its contribution to our economy up some 90% on the previous quarter with very strong prices. And our expectation is that will continue. Now, the United States hasn't signed up to the proposal from the UK. We know that they're bigger in their domestic production in total for met and thermal than our entire export plus domestic production for Australia. Our thermal coal production is just 4% of the world's production. It's an important part of the economy for regional communities.
OK, so the momentum, though, 40 countries have signed up to this and another 150 organisations. The Asian Development Bank, despite Australian pushing, is no longer going to loan out to coal projects. The momentum is there, isn't it, to reduce coal use in the world? That's pretty clear.
Tom, I live in the world of the reality. The reality is that demand is expected to increase, particularly into Southeast Asia. We expect that there'll be some reduction off peak by 2050. But it'll still be a significant part of the world's energy mix, and that will continue for a long time.
So that's the interesting question, though, a long time. That's a possibility, but that will depend, with the world going to net zero, on carbon capture and storage becoming cheaper and more effective, won't it? If that doesn't happen, there's no certainty about technology, if that doesn't happen, coal's future wouldn't happen beyond 2050, would it?
Oh, I don't agree with that at all. I mean, we've got any number of countries that are continuing to build coal generation. Yes, CCS and technology will help us find a way forward, as will abatement technologies, dual fuels, the addition of hydrogen or ammonia in terms of the fuel mix, biofuel, gasification. There's a lot of parts to this argument. But, Tom, you know, once again, back in the world of the practical reality, name me how many companies you can think of that have lasted for more than 50 years, and there are very, very few. So longevity in business is very difficult to achieve in any form, in any part of the economy. But I have great confidence in the future of Australian coal.
But in a macro sense, so many countries, I think, you know, China's 2060, so maybe you can say perhaps some coal use out to then. Without carbon capture and storage, in a net zero world, coal being used for electricity generation won't happen. Do you agree with that?
No, not at all. I mean, there are countries who are not going to throw away their brand new generation equipment, which they've just installed or they're in the process of
installing. It's not going to be brand new in the 2050s,
planned and designed. Yeah, but they last for absolutely decades, Tom. I mean, we've got significant installations that have been around for a long time, depending on what technology you're using. I mean, I did an upgrade on a hydro facility in North Queensland for its 50-year upgrade. So, you know, the generation component just moves on these brownfield sites. But I've got complete confidence in our sector. We're incredibly competitive and we have a high-quality product.
Competitive for now, but, I mean, you mentioned a lot of countries not signing up to the agreement to phase out coal. Korea, South Korea has our second biggest customer and coal will be phased out next decade. That has to have some impact on Australia exporting coal, doesn't it? Second biggest customer.
Well, once again, back to reality. The reality is that places like New Zealand have made similar commitments and yet they're importing Australian coal and coal from Indonesia right now to make sure they can keep the lights.
So you don't believe them?
So
you don't believe Korea won't do it?
It's not a matter of whether I believe them or not.
You're basically saying they won't do it.
Well, Tom, in this debate, there's been a lot of people who make commitments, who sign pieces of paper, but the reality is Australia has reduced its emissions by 20%. That is significant compared to many other nations.
Right, but I'm not even asking about Australian emissions.
New Zealand.
I'm asking about the future of the resources industry, and you as Minister, when you're asked about whether our second biggest customer stopping the use of coal will have an effect on our industry, you're saying, well, they're only signing a bit of paper, they won't do it.
Oh, well, that's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying people have made commitments that haven't come through. I'm saying there is significant installation going on around the world for coal-fired generation. Mm. We have one of the highest quality products in the world. That's why people buy it, in terms of its calorific content,
right,
no
but
ash, and all but the other things that come from Australian coal.
Are you saying you don't believe the Korea pledge will happen?
Tom, what I'm saying is there's been any number of commitments made by a number of countries over many, many years, including some for more than a decade.
But I'm asking about the Korea pledge.
Once again, let's go back.
When you talk about other countries not fulfilling a pledge, you're indicating the Korea one, what, might not happen?
Well, you're singling out a particular country for a particular issue. They are incredibly
important. Well, because they've signed the pledge and they're our second biggest customer.
Well, I have met with my counterpart in previous months, as I have in Japan and others around the world. They remain committed to Australia's supply of energy. Now, as that mix changes, and it may well change over many decades, we'll continue to look to fill that mix, whether that's through LNG,
right,
whether it's through hydrogen, whether it's through coal. And if we look at the HESS program, for example, in Victoria, the hydrogen's being produced there comes from lignite, comes from brown coal. So there are future opportunities for coal, not just the ones that exist already.
So, but isn't that the point that you mentioned green hydrogen, that we have a future in energy, and that's the great thing, the sort of hypothetical transition we used to speak about has now become a tangible one, green hydrogen. That's the thing we'll more likely be using in future decades to export, and there's nothing wrong with that. If we switch from coal to green hydrogen, that's not a problem, is it? You wouldn't have an issue with that?
Oh, well, once again, we're in the market as a trading country to supply what our customers demand. And if that's what they demand, that's what we provide. And now we expect LNG exports, for example, to increase because demand will continue to increase around the world. We've got opportunities with the strategic basin plan and the gas-led recovery that we've put forward to make sure we are filling those gaps. But that doesn't mean we can't continue to support our traditional industries, make sure they're successful and keep all of those jobs, particularly in regional Australia.
Well, perhaps you can keep them and in other industries anyway. I'm sure we'll pick up the conversation another day. Always good to talk, Minister. Thank you.
Great to be with you.